Hi, welcome to today's Klynt Advanced webinar, in which we will go through some advanced features in Klynt, such as the iframe, the web video feature, the sync navigation, and we'll see also the customization of Klynt's widgets. This is what we'll see today, and also in the end, how to eventually publish your project on the web. So what we will do is we will open the project we started the other day, this one, July 31st. In our project gallery. So we just need to double click to open the project. And here we are. For those who remember it, this is the project we started to work on in the beginners webinar. And we will start from the bar sequence. Double click to enter the bar sequence. As you probably remember what we did in the bar sequence, we created a few texts and a button, and then we apply a style to those text and buttons. Now what we will do is we are going to work a little bit with this image of the piña colada. We will take the image here and maybe we'll first make sure those texts will appear not right now but a bit later, and we will change their time code on the timeline, and back to this picture, which lasts from the beginning until the end of the sequence. And also, that's just a useful tip. You see the sequence time is 30 seconds, and if I want to work more comfortably, I can use on the top right of the timeline this thing here to have a closer view on time, which allows you to work more comfortably. So what I would like to show you now is also adding some style effects to this picture. First of all, you should know Klynt is not an animation software, not yet. We're working on adding some more animation possibilities, and hopefully we will be able to offer you this shortly, we hope so. But right now in Klynt 2.12, I'm sorry, Klynt isn't really an animation software such as After Effects or other things, Hype or whatever. Yet, there's a very simple and basic level of animation of tweening interpolation that you can do in Klynt. Let me show you how. I will simply double click on this image here. And when I double click on the image, I have another pop-up window which opens itself, and I see here I have a start position and here an end position. That would mean that during a given time, this piña colada picture will move from here to there. That is to say, from a point A to a point B in a certain time. And so this is a very basic level of animation. That's really the principle of interpolation in the first place, of twinning. It is simple, yet this is what you can do for now in terms of moving an element animated. And hopefully, like I say, let me repeat that, we hope to soon offer you more exciting animation possibilities. So it's good to say this image will move from here to there, but for how long? And that's the question. And if we take a look here at the image properties inspector, as you can see, let's skip the position and size and responsive settings, because like I said also in the previous webinar, this isn't the responsive webinar, so we will not go through that today. Fill options, we've talked about it about the video. And let us take a look at this animation drop down we have here. And we can select to have no animation at all, which is the default mode, or to select what we call the pan and zoom. So the pan and zoom from here to there, from point A to point B, we can set it a certain duration. And for instance, I will set it to 3 seconds. And this is pretty much the way to do it. And as you can see here, double click, I chose to display here the end position on the scene, that is to say on the WYSIWYG editor or the canvas. This is why when I click OK, I no longer see my picture here, but I do see it here. even though what will happen for this picture is that it will move from the top left to the bottom right during a 3 second duration on a very linear manner. And until now, we don't have really can offer Klynt user much more control on that, but soon enough, you will be able to do more. And if you take a look at the timeline, you can see that our Pina Colada picture here, I light in yellow because this is the track we are editing, now has a little symbol with two images. That means that it has a pan and zoom animation here. Let us take a look. And I remember you that you can run your sequence like that or use the keyboard shortcut Command R or Control R if you're on PC. So as you just saw, the image did the animation from the top left to the bottom right within a 3 seconds duration. It also had a fade in 1 second apparition. This is why you did appearance, I'm sorry. This is why apparition, this is why you didn't see it very well at the beginning, but it worked. Let me refresh the sequence to watch that again. And here we go. So it is quite simple, I admit, but hopefully we'll be able to do more soon. And even though it is simple, you can still do some nice stuff. For instance, there was somebody who did a project with Klynt, and the home page were just pictures coming from here to there, or here to there, or here to there, with different sizes and etc. at different speeds. And so in the end, it seemed like sort of a mosaic of a patchwork. And then after a given time, like 5 seconds, there would be some invisible shapes. When you would click on each and every picture, that would give you access to different sequences. And this way you can really create a dynamic menu, even though it's a very simple use of animation. Now let's do some more stuff on this picture. And let us explore a little bit the FX tab, which we haven't done so far. What about the FX tab? It says effects, you might also say style, because you can work on a few things and give effects. First of all, there's a little drop down here. You can work on the opacity. You can make it more or less transparent or totally have a full opacity. Let's say we want this to be 0.5 opacity, right? Half transparent. And what's interesting is here you have a little plus sign. What is this plus sign? If I click it, it offers me a rollover cursor. And I can also move it from 0 to 1, and this one will go full to 1. What is rollover? For those who don't know it, rollover means that your element, in this case, this photography, will have a different state, behavior, or state, to say it more properly, when the mouse will be over the element. That is to say, the appearance, the style of this element would be different on a default mode and when your mouse is rolling over it. So there will be two different states. You can also work on the background, but it doesn't really is useful here. It's not very useful here because there will already have a picture filling the container. We might also work on the rotation. And let's say, okay, you don't move, but hitting the plus sign on the rollover, I would like you to do a 360 degrees rotation, and we'll see if this works. You can also add border to the picture if you want to. For instance, here I will set, let's say, a red border, give it maybe a 5 pixel size. And you can also change the border radius. What's the border radius? For those who don't know, it means the angle. The angle of the element by default is totally square, if I may say. But you can really make it more round. And I could say, for instance, a 5 pixel radius, border radius. But hitting the plus sign, I could say, okay, when I will roll over, I will change this color. I will make the border yellow and I will make it bigger, such as 10 pixels. And same for the border radius. Could also add a shadow, which is not maybe what I'm going to do. Not in this case, but if I wanted to, I could add a white shadow or a light blue shadow, whatever. All right. By the way, let me just take a brief parenthesis here. And that's also true for text styles and button styles, which we discussed in the previous webinar. Some people might say, oh, those are the only colors I can put, that the only colors I can apply to text style, button shapes, borders, etc. No, as you can see here, we do have an hexadecimal code. That is to say, if you can simply write down or copy and paste an hexadecimal code, that is to say mixing six numbers and letters, then you will have millions of possible colors, even more than the human eye can see. So no problem, you can really here apply the color you want. You're not limited to this little palette here. That was just to say quickly. Anyway, end of the parenthesis, we're not going to put a shadow, but we'll see the last drop down here, which says animation properties. We could also say transition properties if we were speaking in the CSS language, actually. What does that mean? That is to say, I set different states for opacity, for rotation, and for border color and size, by the way. But is it going to happen at once? That is to say, when the mouse will be hovering the element, will it change just like that? I can make a smooth, pleasing transition and changing state using the animation properties panel. And the default duration is 0.5 seconds, but I could say, okay, I would like that to happen for, let's say, 3 seconds. And whenever you choose the duration of these changing states, you can also select the type of transition you would like, whether linear, that is to say, like that, it will go very fluidly and be at the same pace all the time, or easing. Easing means it starts slowly, then it accelerates. The transition is out is the contrary. It starts quick and then it slows down. Easing out is a mix of the two. As for me, I have a preference for easing. I will select the easing transition. And last but not least, we do have a reversible checkbox. What's reversible? That means that when your mouse will be hovering the element, all those effects and style changes will happen. And when you take your mouse off the element, reversibly, it will come back to its default state. I don't know if that's clear for everybody. Now let us save this and let us take a look. So here's my picture moving. It has a 0.5 opacity. I can't see it so well. It has a red border of 5 pixels and a border radius of 5 pixels. What happens when my mouse will be hovering this picture on a rollover? 1, 2, 3. And within a 3 seconds duration with the easing transition, my opacity went full to 1. The border change its color to some yellow, a bit greenish here, and the border radius went also more round. And what happens when my mouse goes away? Here's the reversible thing. So those are the types of effects you can add, not only to a picture, but also to a text, to a shape, or even a video if you wanted to. Okay? Maybe this is a bit exaggerated. But anyway, this is the type of thing you can do if you want to make your sequence more dynamics and elements more dynamic. This is the type of things you can do in Klynt. Now, what I will do, go back to Klynt. We're going to go back to the storyboard. We can click here next to the Klynt logo. Remember, you can also access it from the view menu and select storyboard or use the keyboard shortcut Command-B. And then we are back to the storyboard. Now what I will do is show you some more advanced features in Klynt, such as the iframe, the first thing we are going to see. So I will create now a new sequence. Let me right click on the storyboard to create a sequence. Here's the sequence. I will make it bigger, change the color, make it maybe green. Here we are. Let me put it here. I will name this sequence iframe. And I will write down a few tags such as iframe, YouTube, Marcos Valle, Brazil. That will do. Description, Estrelar music video by Brazilian Marcos Valle. All right, I just did it for once for today's webinar. Like I said in the previous webinar, we do recommend, it's not mandatory, but we do recommend you give names to your sequences and also tags and description. And later on today's webinar, I will show you why, because this is not only for you, but it is also information that can be accessible to your viewers. And we will see that later. So nothing mandatory here, though it is recommended. And if you do, if you write something, write it properly, I would say. I think Brazilian in English comes with a Z. Anyway, I might be wrong, but it's just an example. For the other sequences, I will not do it again because we have to do other things and see other things. Yet, I recommend you would do that for each and every sequence. Now, let me make a link between those two sequences. Remember, I can make a link by grabbing the white spot and making a link this way. But if I do that, this will create a button in the bar sequence. And this is not really what I want, because what I want is to go back to the bar sequence and make a link from this picture. Remember, in the previous webinar, we already did some links with text, with buttons, with shape, and we can also make a link with an image, obviously. We just need to go to the link tab. Select go to sequence in the dropdown, which sequence, to the iframe sequence, and once more, sorry for repeating myself for those who attended the previous webinar, but this is why it is best for you in order to work in a better way to give names to your sequences, because if you don't and we only have sequence 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, you will be lost. If you give your sequences names, you will work faster and more efficiently. Anyway, sequence iframe, I can add a tooltip. And in this case, I will write down Brazil because we're going to Brazil. And I can select a type of transition also. Remember, this is a catalog of jQuery transitions. And I will select, for example, the pop transition to go to the other sequence. Let us see if this works. I could run it from here, Command R, or I might as well click the button above the timeline, this button that directly opens the sequence in my web browser. So here it is. Now let me roll over this picture. Here's my transition animation and the tooltip Brazil. What if I click? Pop transition to the iframe sequence. And as you know, let us take a look in the URL to see we're working locally. We're offline currently. But after we are sort of an hashtag that says iframe, that means we're now on the iframe sequence. And of course, for now, there's nothing in it. It is empty. It just has its black background. We will be working with the iframe. Let's go back to Klynt, back to the storyboard. And here's the link. Let me zoom in here so we can see it better. Let me change the color, make it green so you will see it better. And let's work on the iframe sequence. Double click, and here we are. So, first of all, remember I said we always have a black background. Well, if we want, we can give it another color, such as, I don't know, light blue, here it is. Play with the opacity, we can do that. And let's say now we no longer have a black background. That's a possibility. Anyways, just an example. Now, how do you work with the iframe? It is very simple. You just need to go here in the timeline and in the interactive object track, right click on an empty track. You can add a button, add a shape. We're not going to do that. We are going to add an iframe. And the iframe feature is only available with Klynt Professional Edition. All right? And you will see why in a minute. So let me put an iframe, and this is what we have, a 5 seconds thing because it doesn't have yet a duration of its own. So let me put it at the beginning and expand it until the end of the sequence. Now I should double click to edit the iframe, and I will do that. And this is what I have. What do I have? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Why is that? Because I just need hit. I just need here to write down an iframe. So that leads us to the question, what is an iframe? For those who don't know, an iframe basically is just a few lines of HTML code, like you say a brick of code, which allows you to embed some content from the web. And nowadays, almost everything from the web is embeddable. Many web platforms containing multimedia, video, sound, text, or maps, whatever, many things, offer you an iframe code. You just need to click the embed or iframe code, and then what we will do is simply copy and paste an iframe code here. And this is the way we will embed and integrate an iframe in Klynt. Let us go to Google Chrome. Let us go to, for example, let's make an example with YouTube. And here we will select Marcos Valle Estrella, which happens to be some nice funky. Brazilian music that I like, funky from the 80s, but anyway, it's just an example, it doesn't really matter. So what I will do now, I have this YouTube video that I like and I would like to put in my Klynt project. So just below the YouTube video, well, right now it's in French, but I have something that says partager. In English, it would be share, and clicking here, I can share this video. All right, I could just simply copy and paste the short URL, send it to my friend, say, hey, do you like this music, blah, 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 whatever. Okay, nice. But this isn't what I want. What I want is to hit integrate, iframe, or embed in English it would be. And if I hit that, now YouTube offers me an iframe code. So what I simply need to do is to copy the iframe code, then go back to Klynt. And here I will simply paste the iframe code. And that simple, I just iframed a video from YouTube. Am I done? Not totally. Quite, but not totally. One last thing I need to pay attention to, it's the size of this iframe. As you can see, if we take a look at what it says iframe with 560 pixels, of course, 8,315. And then later on it says SRC, which stands for source in HTML language, and the source of this iframe, what it will embed actually, is this youtube.com embed blah 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 blah, that being this video, all right, with no border, 0 pixel frame border, and I can also play full screen, and that's it. The only thing I need to pay attention to regarding for me, you see, you don't need to be a code expert to copy and paste iframes, not very difficult, is the size of this iframe, its dimension. So here I have an iframe property box window, an inspector. So I will go to the general tab and pay attention to the size of this iframe. The default is a square of 300 pixels per 300. In this case, my iframe should be cropped, and I don't want it to be cropped. So I'm going to give it the same size, 560 by 315, and that's it. So now let's not go through the responsive settings now. Then I just click OK, and here it is. I should have an iframe now with the YouTube video. So let me go back to the bar sequence. Remember, I can go back to the bar sequence using the tabs just over the timeline here on the top left of the timeline. I don't need to go systematically through the storyboard. So let us go here and let us play the sequence with the Command R keyboard shortcut. Here we are, Brazil. Let us click pop transition to the iframe sequence, and I change the background color, and now I have the YouTube video. And it works. It is fantastic. I just that simply took a video from YouTube and displayed it into Klynt. So a couple of words about the iframe feature. First of all, remember that I told you Klynt is a desktop application. It is accessible here on the dock as a classic software type of installation, such as Photoshop or Audacity or whatever. And you can work with Klynt, edit your Klynt project, even though you don't have an internet connection or a bad one, a lousy web connection. If you're in your country house, on the train, on the plane, something, somewhere there's not the web, no problem. But of course, and that's about the iframe, if you want to work with the iframe and embed stuff from the web, in this case, you would obviously need an internet connection, okay? You just need to be fully aware of that. If you want to grab stuff from the web, you need to be on the web. So you can use the iframe feature if you don't have an internet connection, first. Second, I just showed an example with the YouTube video, but iframe feature, of course, isn't limited to YouTube videos. You could iframe almost anything. Let me show you another example. For example, a friend journalist living in Belgium did a web documentary about DJing and some famous DJs, all right? Let us take a look here. It was made with Klynt, all right? Trying to look for its webdoc. Where is it? Here it is. And what this journalist did is that all the interviews he did.
Mais mes premiers débuts de DJ en fait, de disquaire.
Were recorded and then put in SoundCloud. You probably know SoundCloud, it's a platform for audio files. It's like some people call it the YouTube of music or the YouTube of sound, right? So what he did here is simply iframe SoundCloud players with his interviews that he wanted to appear in SoundCloud. So that's another possibility you can do. You can, you know, really you could iframe stuff from YouTube, videos from YouTube, Vimeo, Dailymotion, any video platform, sound from SoundCloud, it is possible. If you're a professor or student, you can take presentation you do from SlideShare or Prezi. If you want to display a PDF file, it is also possible. It is very easy. You could use programs such as Scribd or whatever to directly display a PDF player and put a PDF file or even a Word file. Those are the things you can do thanks to the iframe feature. And this is why, let me go back to the iframe sequence. The iframe is very powerful. This is why it is only available in Klynt's professional edition, because it really empowers your Klynt project and make you go beyond the traditional multimedia, that is to say text, photo, video, sound, and buttons, the things we have seen in the previous webinar. With the iframe feature, you can really use all web resources, almost all, those who are private and cannot be shared, will not be accessible through iframe, but almost all web resources can be taken and put into Klynt thanks to the iframe. So it's sort of, I believe, a very good feature. And note about the video YouTube, the YouTube video, that when you're using it, you are having, of course, the YouTube video player. And so that's the thing. And if the uploader of this video, this YouTube video, decides to delete it or to unpublish this video, of course, obviously, it will also disappear from your Klynt project because you don't have control over this video, you're just simply embedding it, right? Those are some things you should be aware of when you're embedding something. Now, let me show you, for instance, another example. Maybe you've heard of something called timeline.js. It's a nice tool, free tool, made by, I believe, the Knight Lab, and that allows you to create beautiful crafted timelines, as it says. And here you have a timeline. You can navigate, and you can make it rich media with a YouTube video, with a blog post, with a Flickr picture, with a tweet, with say that has a problem, here's another tweet, or a Vimeo video, whatever. You can do a nice timeline. And let me show you an example that we did not so long ago in Barcelona during a Pop Athen and Klynt workshop. This was done with Klynt by people working on the Pop Athen, that's a hackathon that lasts a day and a half. So this is a Klynt sequence. There's a picture, later on there's a text appearing, then there's another text, then appears another picture and a sound. And then what we did, we just did an automatic transition with a button to another sequence. And what's in this sequence? Well, that's some timeline made with timeline.javascript.js, as you can see. And the way we just put this timeline, which is the main content of this project, done within a one-day thing, we use the iframe feature in Klynt. And this is a nice way, really, to show you the type of use you can do with the iframe. You can really integrate some rich multimedia interactive content, not only a video or a sound. That's the way to do it. Another example here, if we click on this text, we add an Twitter feed that is also embedded through iframe. That's simple, right? And then you can also come back to the timeline. Anyway, so those were just to show you really how interesting the iframe feature is for you. I will now show you another way to work with web videos, and that's a bit different from the iframe. And it might get a bit complicated, so you need to pay attention quite much. Let me go back to Klynt. So now here I will add a text. Let me right click here to add a text. Let me expand it to the end of the sequence. Move it here more or less, double click. Now we'll write down Marcos, supposed to be this fella. Add another text with the plus sign. Right click here to copy and right click on the empty track to simply paste it. And here it is. So that's simply, I just copied the text. I don't need to have such a big box. Thank you very much. Let me change the size of this box. It is yet a bit big. Like that, that's better. And let me put this one here. And here I will write down Arnaud. All right, two different people. So now I don't see very well because it's white on a sort of light blue background or light green background, light turquoise background. And so I can change the style of this text. We just did it at the end of the previous webinar using this text style dropdown and select, for instance, the subtitle. And so I'm applying now the style I created not so long ago. So now I have Marcos and Arnaud. So what I'm going to do now is simply go back to the storyboard and let me create two sequences. One being Arnaud sequence. So no time now for tags and description because we have a lot to see, but I do recommend you use it generally speaking. Let me make it large and change the color, maybe make it purple. Here it is. And here's the right click to add another one. Name it Marcos. Right click to make it big and right click to make it maybe pink. And we've been through all the colors yet right now. Okay, so what I will do now, obviously, is go back to the iframe sequence and simply make links from the text track to the Arnaud and Marcos sequence, all right? So here, selecting the Marcos text on the canvas, going to the link tab, go to sequence, which sequence? Well, the Marcos sequence, no need for a tooltip. I will use the slide down transition, which we have not seen so far. The slide down transition is like when clicking on this text, the whole sequence will go down, and that would make the user, the viewer, feel like if he would go up. And I will select, in order to be consistent, the same type of transition for this text track. Go to the Arnaud sequence with a slide down transition. Let us see if it works. Command R. Here we are. Let me click here. Slide down transition going up to the Marcos empty sequence for now. So let us go back to Klynt. Also change the colors here, of course, if I wanted to. Let's make this one pink and this one purple so you will see them better probably. Okay, let us work on the Marcos sequence. So now the feature we are going to see is a very interesting feature of Klynt. It is called web video. And if we go here on the left to the media library, remember we have images, we have videos, we have audio files, and I didn't mention it in the previous webinar, but we also have what we call a web video, and it is yet in a beta version. What's web video? Right now we don't have any, zero, it's empty, but we can add one. How can we do that? First of all, we need to hit the plus sign here. And when we hit the plus sign, a pop-up window appears, and it says web video, enter the URL of your web video. So, let me explain. Web video, actually, it is still in beta. Actually, today only works with YouTube. So you also could name this feature YouTube video instead of web videos, because for now, for technological reason, we can only use this feature with YouTube, not with Vimeo, for instance, not yet, or Dailymotion or another video platform. So I need to enter the URL. Let me go back to Google Chrome. So this time, I'm not going to copy the iframe code. I am simply going to copy the URL here, the address of this YouTube video. Let me copy and go back to Klynt. And I will simply paste it. Let me click OK. And now, in the media library, I do have one web video. And what if I double click? I have sort of an image preview of this video, its name, tags, comments, and description as put by the video's uploader in YouTube. An interesting thing, it is now not an iframe. It's a video that's in your media library as if it were one of your video. And we will see why it is different from an iframe. And if we take a look at the location here, it says http://the code of the video, right? That is to say, even though it is in your media library, it is not copied to your desktop. It is still online and it is located online. What does this mean? This means, of course, such as the iframe, that if you don't have an internet connection when editing your Klynt project and using the web video, it will not work. You need to have an internet connection, obviously. Secondly, it also means, like the iframe, that you will be using something that's on the web, on YouTube, to be more precise in this case. And if the uploader of this video decides to delete this video or unpublish it, then it would also disappear from your Klynt project. And thirdly, some videos put on YouTube are not allowed for sharing. So if the uploader does not accept the sharing options, you will not be able to copy and paste the URL and use it as a web video in Klynt. So those are the first thing you should know before you want to work and play with this feature. Okay? So now we do have this web video. I'm going to drag and drop it and put it here. And here it is. Now it's filling the old frame. And you can see here, I have a YouTube logo, sort of a watermark that says this video comes from YouTube. I'm going to make this a little smaller. And here it is. What's the difference with the iframe, you want to know? Well, the difference is that, look at this external videos property. If I'm going to the general tab, I can lower the volume, I could put video controls or not, launch it automatically or not, even loop this video, and also synchronize the sequence with this media, make it a sync master, which is an advanced feature we will see after this one. We will not discuss this for now. but we can really have video controls, autoplay, and a loop. That is to say, I have control over this video like if it were one of the video as just imported in Klynt previously. And that's very different from the iframe of a YouTube video, because with the iframe, I add the YouTube video player. I didn't have a Klynt video player. So that would be the difference. It really like you would appropriate yourself this video. And I could also, what I could do, let me show you, make the time smaller like that. I could also make this video shorter if I wanted to. And that's kind of powerful because of course you cannot do that with the iframe. When you are using the iframe, you are taking the whole thing. Here, I can even edit the video. I cannot cut it at the beginning for technological reason, not really. Or can I? I don't know exactly. But what's sure is that I can make it shorter. I can edit the video. And I can also, if I go to the effects tab, play with the effects and let's say put more opacity. I can also make it have a rotation, give it a border. I could also do it with the iframe. So let us maybe not do so much with that, but it is important that you understand that. Let me play it. Command R so you would maybe understand better. And one thing that's true, and I just forgot to say because I was going a bit quick. When you are using the web video for technological reasons, it only works in Firefox. So let me open Firefox here. Here's Firefox. And what I will do in Firefox for the time of this exercise, I will go to preferences. Sorry, this is in French, but I was simply in the general preferences. Choose to make Firefox default browser. Here it is. So now let me go back to Klynt and play this sequence. And now, as you can see, it is opening my Klynt sequence in Firefox, no longer in Chrome. So here's my video from YouTube. The difference is that here I have video controls that are Klynt, right? This is the thing. So for now, it only works, let me repeat, with YouTube, not yet with Vimeo or Dailymotion or other stuff. For technological reasons, a bit long to explain, but usually this, I mean, technically speaking, this is working with the API. So it is doable with the YouTube platform, not with other ones. And so I can take stuff from YouTube and really use it as if it were one of my video. How useful is that to me? You might ask yourself. Good questions. Well, there are different ways you could use the iframe, the YouTube web video feature, I'm sorry. First of all, you could really have some extra material like bonus or whatever you want to put in your Klynt project, and you can take it stuff that are related to stuff that is related to your project and put it in a special sequence with YouTube videos. You could do that. You can also use it in an artistic way and even do mashups. Here I can have several image tracks and I could have several web videos from YouTube and I could play with the opacity. I could make long fade out transition of 10 seconds or even more, and I can make those videos mix themselves and really use it in a more mashup way. And I could take stuff that's not mine and use it as if it were mine and really mixing what's already online in YouTube. That could be a way to work with the YouTube web video feature. And a third way would also be possible would be you could say, okay, I'm going to do my web documentary or my Klynt project, but I will first put all my videos in YouTube and then import them into Klynt as YouTube web video. Let me show you an example. Let's go back, for example, to Google Chrome, and let us go to lescatacombes.com, which is an interactive documentary made by a young Spanish filmmaker, and he did it with Klynt recently, a few months ago. All right, So this is his web doc. It was made with Klynt. As you can see here, it has a Klynt footer. It was made with Klynt. Let us take a look. And you can see here, we have a YouTube watermark. And here, we have a play, pause, and video controls. That's Klynt, right? So this is an intro video sequence, and I can jump and go to the instruction. Once more, this is a YouTube video. So by the way, what the filmmaker did here, he did a very short video that explained the viewer how to explore the interactive documentary. And that's also quite good thinking, something that you could do if you want to do that. So if you want to do a web doc, you can also give sort of a short way to do it. Here we have a few sequences, right? And if we choose to click and see this video, for instance, this chapter here, once more, this is a YouTube video, right? That is to say, all the videos in this web documentaries, in this web documentary, were made with the YouTube web video feature. What's the use of doing that? What's the need of doing that? Actually, you don't have to do that. You can, of course, import them regularly as video. But the purpose of putting those videos as YouTube video, first of all, could give you a double visibility. That is to say, your video might as well be accessible from YouTube and probably or maybe have quite an audience, a lot of audience on YouTube. And in the description, you could say, go see this video in my interactive Klynt production or web documentary and make a link to your Klynt production. And first of all, you could use that for the visibility. The second interesting aspect of doing that is that this way, and if we take the Katakon project, his project is Klynt project is very, very, very light because he has no video in it. All videos are hosted in YouTube, right? So his project only have a few text and buttons, images. There's no video in the project. All the videos come from YouTube. So that would be another reason if you want your project to be very, very light, but it's no problem. You can also, and this is why Klynt was made for, use the regular video in order to make it. Reasons why you wouldn't want to put your videos on YouTube could be also some. First of all, you could say, I don't want to see a YouTube watermark. I don't like that. Another aspect could say, okay, I don't like the YouTube video compression because you know, when you upload a video on YouTube, they also, like we do in Klynt, give you a certain number of settings of compression settings and parameters to respect. So you do a first compression and optimization by yourself. Then later on, YouTube makes a second one. And you could say, okay, I'm unhappy about the way YouTube compresses my video, so I don't want to display my videos on YouTube. And that would be perfectly a good point, right? Each and every one of you are really free to do that or not. Another aspect in which it will maybe not be a good idea to put your own videos on YouTube is if you aim to show your web documentary or your Klynt production somewhere where there's no web connection. If you do an interactive doc in the deep Amazonian forest or in the Sahara, and then you come back and you want to show that to the people you did the documentary with. Maybe there's no internet connection in the deep forest or in the deep Sahara desert. So you can show it from your laptop to your people or even if it's screen, if you don't have internet. And that could be also true for the Katakon project. If he wants to show his project in the catacombs, there's no internet connection down there. So you will not be able to see the project because all the videos are hosted in YouTube. So those are the kind of things you need to ask yourself. But about how to use the YouTube web video feature. But in the first place, let us remember and state that the purpose of a Klynt production is to go online, of course, and to be accessible through the web. So it might be useful. It is for you to see. This is what I wanted to point here about the YouTube video. The difference, really, you can appropriate those videos and make them yours. That's pretty different from the iframe feature in which you will always be depending on a YouTube video player. And this is probably not as immersive as the YouTube web video feature. Now, let us go to the Arno sequence and work a bit more with video and see other functional features of Klynt, advanced features of Klynt. So I want to have a better look here. That's a bit small, so let me see it this way. It is better. So let me select a video here, such as this Arno video, drag and drop, and put it here. Here it is. Let us click on the video track to select the media. And let us take a look at the inspector. We can play with the volume, okay? We can have video controls, autoplay, loop, things you know. And if we take a look at the fill options, here this is the zoom. And actually this video was shot on a 16:9 HD video ratio. And remember our clean player in this case, in our project, is also a 16:9 ratio. Its size is 970 pixel by 545 pixel. And even though the video is native is 710 pixel by 400 pixel, that's also a 16:9 ratio. So because it is a fit to window, it fits the old window and it goes full window. It goes full frame in the clean player. And nothing is cropped because it is the same ratio. So this first thing is different from the concert video we were working with, in which it was a 4:3 ratio, if you remember, if you attended the previous webinar. And so with a different ratio, the zoom was cropping the video. So we selected the letterbox fill option. In this case, no problem, zoom is fine and nothing is cropped and the video goes full frame because it is fit to window. So first of all, that was the first thing I wanted to point out. Secondly, what we will see now is to synchronize the sequence with this media checkbox. Let me select that. Once I select that, here you will see a little symbol here. That means this media has become the sync master. And what does this mean? This means that all other media we will display on the sequence, whether text, whether picture, whether sound, iframe, buttons, whatever, we will display them on the timeline and they will always be synced to this video. And once you select the synchronize, in English we call it the sync master, right? It is called the sync master. This video is a sync master. Once you select that, the duration of the sequence becomes the duration of the media. This video lasts 1:22. So now the sequence lasts 1:22. The time of the sequence becomes the time of the media. The media runs the whole sequence and everything in it. What type of media can be sync masters? Two type of medias, video and sound. That is to say, media who have a duration of their own. A photo or a text or a button cannot be a sync master because it has no duration of its own. That can only be a video or a soundtrack, okay? So, in order for you to understand maybe, let me quickly put a few more pictures in here. Let me take the piña colada picture. I like piña colada a lot, actually. Let me make this a bit smaller, put it here, okay? And on the timeline, let me put it to roughly 30 to 40 seconds, more or less. Now let me take another picture, such as the saxophone picture, put it here. Remember, it is big. You can resize it with the selecting the corner and maintaining the shift key of your keyboard, you can change the size respecting the proportion of this image. Let me put it here, roughly. And this time I will put this run beginning at 50 seconds, more or less, and also lasting some 10 seconds, approximately. And let me add now another picture. None of those ones, maybe. I'm gonna use a Klynt logo here. So let me go back to Google Chrome. We're on the Klynt.net webpage. By the way, now we are going to make Chrome our default browser again. So how can I do that? Here, selecting settings. Very quickly, let me make Google Chrome the default browser. Here we are. So every time we will run the clean sequence in the browser, it will open itself in Google Chrome. And once more, let me repeat, when you do that, working on the editing mode of Klynt, we do recommend you use Google Chrome or Firefox, which usually work better than Safari or other web browsers. When your project will be published, no problem. It can be seen on all web browsers, but when editing your project, best with Google Chrome and Firefox. So on the Klynt website, let me go down, and here we do have actually a press kit. And on the press kit, I will select this logo here. I like it. Download the full res version, and here's my logo. And let me show you something nice. I can simply drag and drop the logo and put it on the desktop. And from the desktop, I will put it directly here in the media library. Here we are. Let me go back to Klynt. So now that quickly, I just imported a Klynt logo, a PNG, right? Very easy, isn't it? Now let me make this one a bit smaller, like that, and put it here, more or less. Here it is. So what I'm going to do now is make it begin at 110, more or less, and last until the end of the sequence. That's fine. Okay. Why did I do that? Because I want to show you how the Sync Master works. This is the video Sync Master. So whenever I select the Sync Master checkbox, I'm going to lower the volume. We don't need it here. It's going to bother us. Even though for those who understand French, it's an interesting video about a minute in which Arnaud explains why Klynt is a desktop application. And the two most important points are that he says that it is more stable than an online tool. It's really more stable and works better for a multimedia editing tool, firstly. And secondly, it also gives you, like I showed in the previous webinar, access to your code. And that gives the Klynt user more ownership on his project, and he can enter and edit the code, HTML and JavaScript and CSS, if he wants to. By the way, of course, I forgot to say it because for us that's obvious, but maybe you don't know, this person on the video is Arnaud Dressen, our beloved boss, and the founder of Onkitong Film, co-founder of Onkitong Film, and Klynt, the software we're dealing with. Okay, so what I wanted to say is when you select the Sync Master, which is what I just did, you no longer can choose to select or not select the video controls. Actually, it is selected. You don't have the choice. If you're Sync Master, you will always have video controls. What are video controls? A play pause button and a progress status bar. Why? Why can I take it off? Why should I have it on all the time? Let me show you how. Let me show you why. Control R to run the sequence. So here's the video, hello Arnaud. Here is the play pause button. Here's the progress status bar. And if I'm going to 30 something seconds, here's my piña colada picture. And if I'm going to 40 something seconds, and that was 50, I believe. Here's my 55 seconds something. Here's my saxophone picture. And if I'm going to 117, here's my Klynt logo. What does this mean? What does Sync Master mean? This means that whenever your viewer will be using the progress status bar, it will navigate in time, but not the time of the media itself. This is what we saw in the previous webinar for the concert video, Idriss Boudrioua concert video. In this case, it's not only navigate in the time of the media itself, but navigating on the old timeline of the sequence with those media, those pictures here, synchronized with the sequence. So this is why this video is called the Sync Master, because the progress status bar below isn't the timeline of the media, it is the timeline of the sequence that the viewer, the Klynt viewer, and your audience can navigate in time with. It is important to understand. I hope this is clear enough. So really, all those elements, those three pictures, are now synced to this video. So you might think, but that should be normal, that's obvious. In a sense, yes, and the Sync Master is available since Klynt version 2, which I would like to remember you was released in February 2013, that is to say, a year and a half ago, more or less. And Klynt version 2, like I said last time, I will repeat it for those who don't know, is HTML5 and JavaScript, and the Klynt player is open source. That is to say, you can access the code and edit the code and implement some more features and functionalities in your Klynt player if you have some coding skills or if you have the opportunity to work with a web programmer. If you don't, no problem, no hard feelings. Just use Klynt on a WYSIWYG basis. This is why it was created for. But be aware that you can also access the code since Klynt version 2, that was not the case in the Klynt first public release in 2011, which was Flash-based. And also Klynt V2, because it's HTML5 and JavaScript, can be seen and displayed on all devices, including mobile devices such as the iPad or the iPhone. By the way, close this parenthesis. So like I said, the Sync Master feature appeared with the Klynt V2 version a year and a half ago. And sometimes you probably wanted to watch a video on the web, and before you would see it, there was something here because the video was buffering before it started, right? I guess that happens to most of you. It happens to me many times. And sometimes that could happen also with Klynt before. So whenever that happened, the sequence would begin, but the video was late because there was some buffering. And then when that happened, all other media, like picture or text or things you want to appear at a given time in your video, etc., were out of sync because the video buffered. And it's just a simple, silly thing, but it really was very annoying for a Klynt user because you were having a hard time trying to sync your elements, and because of the buffering when launching your project on the web, then things were out of sync. Luckily, now you no longer have this type of problem, because if you select the Sync Master option here, everything will be synced to the media. And if the video buffers a little bit for a few seconds, a couple of seconds, that can happen. In this case, all the other media will wait, more or less, you could say wait, until the video begins, and then everything will be perfectly synced. This is the point of the Sync Master in the first place, right? So this is why the Sync Master is pretty useful. Everything will be synced, and the viewer can navigate on the progress status bar to navigate in your sequence, which of course not necessarily only contain the video, but other stuff. Now let me show you something more, which is nice. Let me write down a text here, right click on an empty track, make the text last all the time of the sequence. Let me write down Piña Colada. It almost became a leitmotif. It seems like that. Let me put it here. It's a bit big. Don't need to have it so big. Well, I can hardly see that because it's white on a white background. So I can use the text type to change it and maybe use the subtitle. Yeah, that looks pretty good. Let me hit the plus sign to add another text track. Let me simply copy and right click to paste again this text track. And here I will write down, for example, saxophone. Here we are. And then hit the plus sign to create another text track. Paste it again. And move it here. And here we will write down Klynt, because yes. So why am I doing that? Do you have a clue why I'm putting those texts here? It's because I want to show you another feature, which is, I believe, pretty nice and that not so many users use. And I believe it's a pity, it's a shame, because It's an excellent feature in Klynt. If I select this text, now I'm going to go in the inspector and not going to the effects tab, not going to the link tab, now you know, I will go to the actions tab. Remember in the previous webinar, we saw an action that was to close the overlay. That's a possibility. But here, what I will select is not close the overlay, but the seek feature. What's seek? Seek is like we used to say for those who knew Flash, TC go to. That is to say time code go to. And that allows you to navigate in time. In what time? Well, the time of this sequence, right? And if I select, for instance, go to 30 seconds, when clicking on this text, I will jump in time, the viewer will jump in time to the 30 second mark. Same thing here. Let me select actions, go to seek. That's not go to, but seek, I'm sorry, 50 seconds. And here, Klynt, actions, seek. And the time code here is minutes, seconds, and hundredths. So here I will say, okay, let's go to 1 minute and 10 seconds. Let me save this and let us see if this works. Let us run the sequence in Google Chrome. Okay, now let me click Piña Colada. And as you can see, I jumped in time. If we take a look at the progress status bar, I jumped to the 30 seconds duration. And what if I click saxophone? Jumping in time to the 50 seconds mark. And if I click on Klynt, jumping in time to 1 minute and 10 seconds. And once more, this allows me to navigate in time. And it is much better to do that, to use this feature, this seek feature, in a sequence in which your main media, in this case, this video, is a sync master. Because it says go to timecode, and this media is the sync master. It is the media which runs the whole sequence, right? So this allows me not only to navigate in the media, but actually in the whole sequence with the other elements, such as those pictures, right? So the seek feature allows you to navigate in time, in the time of the sequence. And I believe it is pretty powerful because this allows you, for example, let's say you have a video interview. Your sequence is a video interview. What type of use could you make with the seek feature? Well, you could make chapters and make your interview more dynamic. And that allows the viewer to select which question you would like to hear, jumping from an answer or a question or a chapter to another within one sequence. Make an interview more dynamic and richer, you could add some extra material such as picture or images next to the character talking on screen. That's a possibility. Another possibility to use the seek feature is probably you could make a sequence that could be a slideshow, right? You could have a picture that lasts, that is full frame and lasts, let's say 5 seconds, another one 5 seconds, etc., etc. And I just put a seek feature to text element, text tracks, right? And once I did that, as you can see, I have a little symbol here that tells me this one as an action, all right? This is a little icon that says this one as an action, this one as well, and this one as well. But I can also select a picture and give it an action, seek. It is also possible, right? That is to say, let us put no action for this one. I could add some buttons or some images I do that could be small arrows, and by clicking, I would jump in time to 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 seconds. And this way, buttons on the left and on the right could give the viewer possibilities to jump from a picture to another if this was a slideshow. So this is also a way you can create a slideshow within one sequence and not only to have automatic changes of images, but give the viewer control on the pace you want to switch from a picture to another using the seek feature in a sequence. That's another possibility. Another possibility could be simply to add a text. You will understand, I believe, quick. will write down, oops, no, it's not what I want to do. Okay. This is not what I wanted to do. I'm very sorry. I wanted simply to select this text and write down watch again. Okay, watch again. Put it here. Let's give it another text style in the text property, maybe the title one. Watch again. Maybe a bit big, but hey, just an example. And you've probably seen that in many videos. I could put it just at the end of the video if I wanted to. I can put it all along. And the watch again, in this case, in the action, go to give it the seek feature. And let's say go to 000 and just put 100. And this way, when clicking this text, I would begin to watch this video again. This is the third use, possible use, and quite useful use of the seek feature in Klynt. Let me save and run the sequence again. Try the watch again here. Let me jump to 30 something, 50 something, 110, and let me click watch again and take a look at the progress status bar, beginning again from the 00 time code. That allows you to start a sequence again from the start. So this seek feature, recapitulating, summing up, allows you to make chapters, for example, in a video or questions in a video interview, jumping in time. Allows you also, you could use it for a slideshow, or you could use it to say watch again and start the sequence again at the beginning of the time code. It just doesn't work with the 00000. You need to put minimum value as 100. Okay? And it works better, more fluently, if you select the sync master for your media master, which can be a video or a soundtrack. It's also true with the soundtrack. Another possibility would be to put an audio track, such as an audio interview, as a sync master, and on which you could put some more text or some more pictures, and clicking on the audio controls, you would navigate in time, not only of the audio track, but repeating again of the whole sequence timeline. That's the whole idea of the sync master. So now we've seen summing up many of the Klynt advanced features. We've seen how to do an iframe. And I show you different examples. It's not only a YouTube video. It could be something from some cloud. It could be music that you like from Groove Shark. It could be a presentation if you're a professor or a student from Prezi or SlideShare. It could be something made, a timeline with timeline.js, whatever. Many, many things can be put and displayed on an iframe. We've also seen how to use the web video feature with the example of the YouTube music video, and really make it as it were yours, one of your videos, such as the Arno video here, right? And remember, you can also choose to grab stuff that's not yours and mix it, or you can display your own videos on YouTube and import them into Klynt with the YouTube web video feature. Regarding the Arno sequence, what we did is take a video, we made it a sync master, and we saw how important and useful can be the sync master. And then we've been through the seek feature, which allows you and your viewers to navigate in the timeline of your sequence. That covers pretty much it. We're not done yet. What I will show you now has to do with the footer. Do you know what the footer is? Maybe you didn't pay attention, maybe you did, but let me play that again. Okay, thank you. What we have just below the video here is what we call the footer. We have a footer, not below the video, below the player to be more precise and accurate. And what's this footer? Let's click index. Wow, what's that? It is an index menu of the sequences. There's also a credits. It is called a widget and a mind map. Wow, what's that? That looks pretty much like my storyboard, doesn't it? Yes, and I can also zoom in and out. Oh, that's pretty nice. And we have some more things sharing options. Okay, can cut the sound, I can go full screen. Okay, exit the full screen, thank you very much. And I can also embed, what's that? Wow, that's nice. We'll go through all this stuff now. Editing the widgets. This is why I wanted to show you now how to customize your Klynt project with the footer. So what's the way to do that? You will go in the Klynt settings, project settings, general settings. So let me remind you that you can edit your general information about your project, project title, subtitle, description and tags, and title, description and tags are the metadata of your project that will be searched after by the search engines of Google, Yahoo, and Bing, by the way. So it's best to be accurate and write proper stuff in order your project has a good SEO, right? You can also put a subtitle. The project title July 31st and subtitle, I will write down beginner and advanced because that covers beginner and advanced features now, okay? Design settings. And this is the first thing we will do before going more into the widgets. As you may be seeing here, we have skin colors. What skin colors? Well, we have a dark gray, white, and sort of a reddish orange color. If I open this widget, I have these three same colors: dark gray, white, and highlight colors such as an red orange color. All right, and of course I can really give the colors I want. I don't have to stick to those colors if I don't like them. What's the way to do that? Go back to Klynt. In the skin tab, that's in the design settings tab. Remember, in for those who were here in the beginner webinar, you can apply text styles, style to text, I mean. You can also apply styles to buttons. This is what we did with the arrow right button. And you can also, if you have the Klynt Professional Edition, add here with the simple drag and drop as many fonts as you want under the TTF format, in the TTF format. This is that simple, okay? Now let's go to the skin. First of all, you can put a splash screen of your own. What's a splash screen? Maybe you didn't see that. Let me go back to Google Chrome. Let me refresh and replay this sequence. Here it is. Did you see it? Let me refresh it again. And again. And again. Here it is. This is what we call the splash screen. There's a small Klynt logo that appears very briefly at the beginning of the sequence, right? And if you have Klynt Professional Edition only, you can customize and put your own logo. If it's the logo of your company, of your organization, of your client, if you're working on a Klynt project for a client, you can really put his logo here. That could look quite nice. About the skin colors, this is where we're going to select them. We offer three palettes: white background, gray text, light blue highlights, or another one, or another one. And if you like none of those, no hard feelings, you can custom and give it the colors you want. I could say I would like, let's say, a white background, a dark blue text, and a red highlight. Those are the colors of France, by the way. Let us preview those colors to see what it looks like. And you saw that changed already. So, as you can see, you are given to see what your skin colors look like with the credits widget when you preview the colors. I have now a white background, a dark blue text, and some red highlights. And it's also true in the footer. The text is blue, and when the mouse is over, it becomes red. This is the highlight picture. Let me click on the index and you see the skin colors appears now everywhere. The old player will stick to those colors, right? Even the sharing options respect now those three colors I just selected. So why do we have that? The point of giving your project a skin is graphic design layer in your Klynt production, and that's pretty important. I said it in the previous webinar, it is important to have a global design thinking approach now. Because when creating a project with Klynt, it's no longer just a film or a video or a documentary or anything. It's a whole multimedia production. And the design dimension, I would even say layer rather than features, the whole design layer, graphic design layer becomes more and more important. Like I say, when people go on a website, if it doesn't look good, most of the people, they don't stay here very long, they go away. So you might have great content. If it doesn't look so good, if it's not very appealing graphically and colorfully speaking, then unfortunately you could lose some viewers, and it would be a pity because you work hard in order to deliver a good work. So it is important to think about graphic design and skin colors. And like I said last time also, a simple yet efficient graphic design should have no more than three colors. It doesn't look so good if you have dozens of colors. So here we have three colors to offer you in the skin, in the general skin. A background color, text color, and an highlight color. And this is minimalistic, I don't know exactly how to say that in English, I'm sorry. Yet I believe you understood my idea. Yes, it is simple. It looks kind of good, I believe. And by the way, quick parenthesis, once you select a skin color in graphic design, you might also want your text styles and button styles to fit with those skin colors, you know. Either they can be close to your skin colors or they can be complementary, that is to say quite different. But it's good to think, like I say, a global design. For today's and the last time webinar, we did some very random examples. So that would not be a very beautiful design to follow. But when you will be doing your own project, it's good to think about it and not thinking this is no important, okay? Another thing you can customize regarding your skin is the primary interface font. The default font is in open source, but I can choose another one. And if I add, for instance, imported more fonts on TTF format, they would be also accessible here. So here I will select, for instance, the Simonetta font. That's a serif font that looks pretty nice. I can make it also a bit bigger, such as 16. Let us go. That's it. Hit preview to see what it looks like now. Let me cut the sound for a minute. And as you can see, I have the Simonetta font that changed. And if I open the credits widget, I also now have this kind of elegant font. That's it. And I changed the size also. Okay, let me go back to Klynt. I can display a watermark. What's a watermark? A watermark is sort of a transparent see-through image. So you can, even if you have the light edition, display your own watermark if you want to put another picture. What a watermark use? For instance, the default thing, the watermark is an image that's a link to a sequence. Then you say, okay, which sequence? Let's say to the start sequence. And if I want, I can choose to display it on the top left, top right, bottom left, bottom right, let's say top left. And I can play from the start sequence or not. Let us say no, for instance. And let us save to see what it's like. Now let me run the sequence again. And now here I have a watermark. It is transparent. When my mouse is rolling over it, I can click it. And that leads me back to the first sequence. And here's the watermark again. going to the concert, clicking on the watermark, going back to the start sequence. And as you can see, except from this start sequence where there is no watermark because I chose not to display it. Apart from this sequence, the watermark appears on each and every sequence. So, a watermark in the Klynt general design settings is kind of like a sort of home button. You could use it as a home button if you wanted to. And you could have a nice logo that you design in Photoshop or Illustrator or whatever. And then that could take your viewer back each and every time to the beginning of your web documentary, or that could lead him to your menu sequence. Or you could also say, okay, that's going to take him or her as a viewer to a web link that could be the URL of your company or whatever. This is, you're really free to do it the way you want. If you want to display a watermark, I don't like it so much, I'm going to put it off, but if you want to, you can put one. Another thing you can do is display a background image. What does that mean? Let me show you again. For example, let's take a look from the footer at the credits widget. You can see we have our three colors: white background, blue text, and red highlight. And the background is just a filling color, white in this case. It looks kind of nice, yet you can say it's a bit naked. There's not much in it. And if you want, you can select to display a background image, which I will do now. Let me browse. And let me select in the Klynt documents, Klynt V2, July 31st, media, photos. Let me select the piña colada, the leitmotif. But for this example, this picture really doesn't have the right size, but let me select it anyway. And if I do that, I think that's nice. I'm going to click save. By the way, if you remember the overlay close button, the little X, you can decide to put it top right, top left, bottom right, bottom left, and put it from X and Y pixel from the top and right, or top and left, etc. That means that when assigning this overlay close button a certain position, then it will apply to all overlay close buttons you put in your Klynt production. I'm not going to change it now, but it's good you know that. And another thing, and we saw that in the previous webinar, if you don't like the overlay X button, close button, you can take whatever text or picture and give it the action close overlay, and it will close your overlay as well. This is another possibility. Anyway, let me click save now and command R to run the sequence, see if this works. Then you open the credits. And now we do have a piña colada background image because I chose to display a background image. And it is pretty important. If you, in your project, you have that one image that's the most representative, that's the most relevant or the most compelling of your project, it would be good to have that as background image in your widget if you want to use the footer and widgets. And look, if I click the index here, I still have the background image, same thing for the mind map. So that's pretty much it about the skin design setting. It took a few minutes, but that's kind of important to know what you can do with it. And now we will go through the widgets. Let me open again the widget settings. Now we've done with general, we've done with design settings within everything. Let us take a look at the widget settings. So, this is, it gets a bit complicated, so I need you, not so complicated, but you should be concentrated and pay attention. First of all, is the footer. Like I said and like I showed, we have a footer below the player. Some people can say, okay, I don't like the footer. Whenever there's a footer made with Klynt, people know this project was made with Klynt and they sort of look alike, and I don't want the people to know is to know it was made with Klynt, blah, 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 whatever. Okay, you don't like the footer? No hard feelings. Put it away. And now, we do have a Klynt project, but we just took away the footer. There is no footer anymore. You can't do that if you want to. Personally, I think the footer is kind of good because we will see it now. It is called a smart footer and we will see why. And it offers you and your viewers plenty of possibilities. So I believe it's best to keep it. But you don't want it? No problem. Just uncheck the show footer. But for us, in today's webinar, we will show the footer. We can give it a certain 8. Its default 8 is 26 pixel. We will leave that for now. But if you want to make it bigger, it's possible to make it bigger. What's in the footer? Links. And the default thing, there are three links. But if we want, we can add some more links and more and more and then take them away, hitting the minus sign. You will see that this footer zone is very flexible. You can customize it the way you want. So first of all, what I would like to do is to add a link. And here I will write down, for instance, Klynt, right? And what does a link does? It can open a sequence of your project, can open a widget, and I will be into widget in a minute. You can also open an overlay sequence if you want to, but I can also, and this is what I will select here, open a URL to the World Wide Web. And let me go to Google Chrome, go to Klynt.net, copy the URL, go back to Klynt, and simply paste the URL. And now I will have always a next accessible link from the footer. It will be here all the time to the Klynt website. It is, and I can also take this and put it in the first place, in the first row in the footer. You can really give your footer links the order you would like. Simply need to move them one above the other. It's very simple. So why is that good? Let me preview the footer again. It's pretty good. Now we have here a Klynt text. And if I click it in another browser tab, that would be target blank. If you remember the previous webinar, I have a link to the Klynt website. This means that I will make maybe those texts a bit bigger because they're a bit small actually. That is to say, you could put down the name of your company or your organization or your school or your client, if you have a client, and there will always be a link to this website that could be useful. Okay, now let me go back to Klynt. Quickly design settings, skin. I will make this a bit bigger. Thank you very much. Back to the widgets. Now, let me take a look at what index says. What's index? What is it? Actually, it is a menu to the sequences of your project. So I don't like the index label so much. I'm going to change it and I will write down sequences. This is possible. I can change the label, just like I can change the label for button, text, shapes, etc. What does that sequences label link does? It opens a widget. Which widget? The index widget. How do you customize the index widget? Simply by going here to the other tab, which is the index menu. Same thing. Let us preview this widget. You cut the sound. So this is the index menu. And as you can see from the footer, it says sequences here. It no longer says index because I just changed the label, right? And here it also say again, index. I can change that if I want to. And what's in here? Those are the sequences from my project. We created 8 sequences. Start, menu, bar, concert, Marcos, Arnaud, iframe, Idris, right? And as you can see, this is a menu with all the sequences. And I can see the name of the sequence, duration, and when the mouse is hovering the thumbnail, I have the sequence description. The first sequence we did in the previous webinar has the quiet street in Paris description. The iframe sequence we did today as the Estrelar music video by Brazilian Marcos Valle description. So please note, when I told you that it is important to give your sequences names and descriptions, not only is it useful to you, it is because in the index menu from the footer, the default setting is that this information is available for your viewers. And you should be fully aware of that if you want to customize your menu nicely and offer information to your viewers. If my mouse is offering other sequences who do not have a description, then there is no description appearing, obviously. But if they do, here it is. What about this index menu? I say it is a small footer because maybe you can see here, there's a small pose logo that means we are watching the sequence. And if I click, for example, on the bar, I'm going to the bar sequence. It might seem obvious, but that means that this is not only meant to look beautiful and give information, but that more importantly, this sequences menu, this index menu, is another navigation mode you are offering your viewers. You should be aware of that. If you don't want to give this type of navigation, no problem. You can remove this sequences link from your footer. You don't need to keep it if you don't want to give access. But the default settings is that there will be an index menu. So pay attention to that, okay? And now you can see here, it says, this is the sequence we are currently watching. And this is a sequence we already watched. It has a little check here. And it is a little, maybe you don't see it very well, it is a bit gray. That is to say, this has been seen already. This is why we call this footer a smart footer, because it recognizes a few information such as been there, watching that, he knows. So, and it's also kind of smart for your viewers, so that's good. Now I'll show you a few things to customize this index widget. First of all, I can change the label. I never liked index anyway, so I write down sec, which stands for sequence, okay? And here I do have two columns, I'm sorry. The first column should be all the sequences of my project. And in the right column will be displayed the sequences that will appear in my menu. So what I will do now is simply put back all the sequences in the left column. And let us say, I don't want to put them all in the right column to be all accessible. I will select the start sequence, the menu, concert, the bar, and Arno. Let us say I just want the sequences. I'm not going to put the sequences accessible in the menu. I don't have to, I could, but it's really up to me. It's up to you when working with Klynt to select it and do it the way you want. And I can also, of course, change the order of my sequences. Can really do it flexibly the way I want. I just change the order. And below we have a few options. Display the sequences on a grid mode. This is what we have, or a list mode. And like I say, the default settings is that it displays the descriptions and duration. I could say, okay, I'm not going to display the duration. That's useless in this case, okay? Now let me preview the widget to see what it looks like now. So this is now what my sec, and I change index to sec. This is what it looks like. I have the start sequence, then the Arno sequence, then menu, then bar, and then concert. I took the other ones away. So you can really customize your sequences menu. You know, you don't have to put them all if it doesn't make sense to you. Let me go back to Klynt to maybe select the list mode and change the order once more to show you it can be done. Let me save that. Let me open it again because sometimes it refuses. And in this case, it did. Please do what I'm telling you. Be nice. All right. And here we have, thank you very much, Klynt, for being nice with me today. We have here a list mode. It's no longer on a grid mode, it's a list mode. And here I have a little scroll bar that allows me to see my sequences vertically on a list mode. And as you can see, the descriptions The description of the sequence is also accessible next to the thumbnail, and it's still a smart menu. Let me go now to the Arno sequence. And once more, this is not only meant to be pure information, but is it's also, of course, a navigation mode you are giving to your viewers. I cut the sound here, of course. And here again, access to my sequences. Okay, so this is something you can do with Klynt. Let me go back to Klynt. I could also make another index menu, and I would write down other sequences. It is possible, right? And in this case, I would put sequences I didn't display, like the iframe, Marcos, and Idris, for instance, just an example, but that could be done, right? Let me save that. And now, let me play it. How can I access that? I don't see my new menu. Of course, what I need not to forget to do now is simply make a link in the footer so I can access this menu. So this is what we're going to do now. Widget settings. There's something you need to know. If you create a new widget, no problem. Just don't forget to make a link from the footer. And I will write down other sequences, right? And I will move it under the other sequences thing, under the sequences thing. What does that do? It opens a widget. Which widget? The one called other sequences, right? And now it should work. Sequences, other sequences. And now I have those three sequences. Why did I do that? What's the use of it? Actually, it's just to show you you're not limited to one sequence menu. You can make several menus if you want to, and if that makes sense for your project. For example, you could do, I don't know, a project about parent and children relationship, just an example. And so you would have some menu with parent sequences, with sequences with the parents, another one with children sequences, and then you would only make accessible children sequences. That could be a way to do that. Or you can separate your sequences according to the different themes treated in the videos. You know, that could be on your sequences. That could be a way to do that. You don't have to make only one menu. You can make several if you want to. Okay? That's about the index widget. Now let us take a look briefly at the credits widget. It say credits and it opens the widget credits. Let us take a look at credits here. So there's a credit widget. You will see a title and subtitle. And we do have two columns, what it's about and the credits. So first of all, title and subtitle are automatically default state copied from the project title in general information, and same thing for the subtitle. Okay, let us take a look. So here, July 31st, that's the name of the project, beginner and advanced is the name of the subtitle, about and credits. And in the about column, this description is copied also from the description I gave in the general information, which I would like to remind you is also the metadata of the project, that is to say SEO information. Okay, why do we have a credits widget? We didn't have it a few months ago, and people who did project with Klynt would very oftenly create a credit page of their own with an about small short text and a credits about who did what, camera, computer, blah, 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 whatever, okay? And sometimes it was well done. It was not very well done all the time. So we say, okay, the people, the users kind of need that. They do it almost all the time. So if they want, we will give them a credit widget that they only need to fill. So there's two columns, what it's about. You can sum up your project here and credit who did it. You don't like the credits widget? No problem. Just remove it from the footer and do your own. no problem. Or you might also hit the credit and open an overlay that can be, or another sequence that is the credit sequence you designed by yourself, no problem. But let me show you quickly how to design that. Could leave here a copy project title from general information. Instead of about, I'm going to write what. I can always edit the label. Instead of credits, write who. What, I can uncheck copy project and I can write down, this is a test to show how the credits widget works. Who, and I'll write down the Klynt team, for instance. All right. Now let me preview that. And as you can see, it's very simple. I just, what? This is a test to show how the credits widget works. Who did that? The Klynt team. So really, it's very easy to customize a credit widget. And I would let you go see that by yourselves. Now, one more thing we have is a search engine, a search module. Did you notice it? It is here, right here. And if I click, I have a search engine that appears and says type here. I can, for example, type, I don't know, Idris. And here it is. This is why, like we said earlier, this is a smart footer. It is smart because it has a search engine included. And typing Idris, I can see I have two results. And that could be the name of the sequence, some text in my sequence, and keywords would also do if I had some keywords in here. And as for the sequences menu we just did, this is also a navigation mode. Now, if I'm clicking on the concert, I will go to the concert sequence. It is not only meant to be beautiful. Let me look now at the credits. I can write down, I don't know, Arnaud, for instance, and he finds the Arnaud sequence. It is a navigation mode, right? So, very simply here, you can choose to display or not to display the search module if you don't like it, up to you. And you can also edit the different labels. We'll not go through that because this is really secondary, but you will see that by yourselves if you want to. We also have, and that's a kind of important widget, a map menu. Let us see what's in the map menu. Actually, let us go back to the footer. As you can see, there is no default map menu. We didn't put it. In Klynt previous version a long time ago, a few months ago, there was always a map that could be accessible. And it didn't work all the time because not all projects need map. Sometimes some map would be pointless. Now, if you watch some web documentaries, which is what we do a lot because we like that a lot, there's almost all the time maps, and I like maps a lot, by the way, but that's not the point. But what the point is that maps shouldn't necessarily be here all the time. You maybe do not need a map for your project. Maybe it's not relevant to put a map, but if it is, so this is why there's no map by default. But if you want to put a map, it is possible. Just go to the map menu and create a map menu. And instead of map, I would write down, for instance, geography, sort of a label I like. And this one's a bit complicated. Well, not so complicated, but it takes several steps to make it. So please pay attention. It would take some 5 minutes more or less, and you will be able to see how it works. So like the index sequences menu, we have two columns here. Now they are empty. And what I will want to do later is to move a sequence from the left to the right column. Here we will see sequences who would have GPS information. And those who have GPS information I would want to display on the map, I will drag and drop and put in the right column. But before that, we need to edit the map options, step 2 on 2 here. So I will click to edit the map options. What's this map? It is a Google map. So we are using the Google API to already integrate Google Map. And quick parenthesis here, this also means that when you will be using this feature, because you will need to be connected to the internet, you will need to have an internet connection because you will be working with the Google Maps online, okay? So it has a default latitude and longitude. Now what I want to do is go back to Google Chrome and go to Google Maps. And I will go, for instance, to 18 Rue Claude Tellier. Paris. Those are Klynt offices where we are right now in Paris, just close to Place de la Nation. If you're ever in Paris, you can come say hi. We'll be happy to see you people. And this is where we are. So if I right click on this point, and if I select in French, plus d'infos sur cet endroit. If you use Google Map in English, it will say, what's here? And I click, plus d'infos sur cet endroit, what's here? Now I have here GPS information of this place. And let me click on that. And now the GPS information appears in the search bar. I have latitude and longitude. So I will just copy the latitude, go back to Klynt, and set it as the default latitude for my map. And I will do the same thing back to Google Maps, copy the longitude, go back to Klynt, and paste it as the default longitude. So now my map is centered on this point, Klynt offices. Well, actually we're a bit far away. We're almost in the space. We're in space. So we need to go with the default zoom, go closer. Zooming, landing on Paris. Here we come. And now we're zooming in to, I think that's a nice default zoom level. We would do that, okay? Another thing I need to set is the minimum and maximum zoom, because you will see we have a plus and minus sign that will allow your Klynt view, your viewer, to go further or closer on the map. And you have the possibility to set a maximum and minimum zoom level. I will do it this way on random very quickly. Okay, now let me save that. So, now what I need to do, of course, is from the footer to make a link. Otherwise, my map will not be accessible. So let me create a new link. And I will write down geo for geography. What does geo do? It will open a widget. Which widget? The one I just named geography. And I'm going to put it here after the sequences. Once more, setting the order I want. Okay, that's nice. Let me click here to preview my new footer. So now I have Klynt sequences, other sequences, and also have a geo, which opens the Google Map centered on the point I just said here where we are located, Klynt offices. But actually, there's no sequences yet. Of course, there's no sequences yet because now I need to give my sequences geolocation information. And how can I do that? Well, I will go back to Google Map again and copy again this latitude, go back to Klynt. And here I will go back to the storyboard. And I'm going to select the sequence. For example, there are no sequence. And here in the sequence property window and inspector, we've been through title, duration, tag description, background color, opacity, etc. Let us take a look at those geolocation here. Here I'm simply going to paste the latitude information and go back to Google Map and copy again the longitude information from Greenwich, and paste it. Sorry, I just went a bit far away. Okay, so this sequence now contains the information. That's nice. Let me run any sequence and see if I can see that. So now that's the sequence. Let me open the geo widget. And now there's my map. But my sequence is not appearing on the map. Why is that? Do you have any idea why it's not appearing on the map? Actually, it's because I need to do one more step in order to see my geolocated sequence on the map. Let me go back to Klynt to show you how. So this sequence has GPS information. I'm going to go back to the widget settings. And here in the map menu, as you can see now in the left column, I do have one sequence which is geolocated. And I need to take it from the left to the right column and then save. And then now I will be able to see this sequence on my Google Map. And here it is. If I click, I can see I have a sequence. And if I click again, going to the sequence. Okay, that is to say, you could have several sequences on your map. Remember, you can set your map anywhere on the Google Map, anywhere in the world. You can give it the default zoom level that you want. If you do, for example, a web documentary about Paris, you could have a view of all Paris, not only one neighborhood, and you would display your sequences on your Paris map. And if you're interactive documentaries about Paris and London, for instance, you can have two maps, one map with the sequences of Paris and one map with the sequences of London. And in this case, what you would do in Klynt is simply go to the widget settings, map menu, and you would have a new map menu and you would name it London, for instance. And then you would put on the right column geolocated sequences on another map. And if you did that, I'm not going to do right now, but if you did that, don't forget to add a link from your footer to your other map. So it's important. It's the same thing as you can do for the sequences menu. You can have several menus if you want to. You're not limited to one. Same thing for the maps. If you want to have several maps, you can do many maps. So let me just sum up very quickly about the sequences. About the map, I'm sorry. First of all, set the map GPS information from Google Maps, right? Latitude, longitude, set a default zoom level. Give then a maximum and minimum zoom level you allow to your viewers. Once you did that, don't forget to make a link from the footer to your widget, right? Then select your sequences on the storyboard you want to give GPS information. You fill here latitude and longitude that you take once more from Google Map. And then the last step consists in going to the widget settings and dragging and dropping from the left to the right column the geolocated sequences you want to appear on the map. This is how you do it. Okay? Now, last but not least, we will see the last widget, which is the mind map widget. What's the mind map? Let me go back here. The mind map actually is, like I said earlier, the representation of your storyboard. This is my storyboard and I can zoom in or out. I can move in here. I can go closer and I can give the viewers visibility and access to my story architecture. And if I click here, it is also navigation mode. I am going to the iframe sequence. And here I'm going to the concert sequence, right? So the mind map is not only meant to look beautiful and look nice, can look nice if you work on a nice storyboard of your own and you give access to your viewers. And once more, look, it is smart. You say, I've seen that. I am watching that. It's a smart footer, remember that. So it's not only meant to look nice, it's also a navigation mode. And in order to sum up about navigation mode, you can give in Klynt to your viewers. Actually, we have quite many. The first navigation mode is the default navigation mode. It's about the one you design in your story architecture, in your storyboard, first thing. Secondly, you can give navigation in a sequences menu. Thirdly, you can give access to your sequences with the geolocation in Google Maps, right? Already integrated. Fourthly, you can give information with the search engine here. And fifthly, I don't know if that's proper English, but let's say fifthly, you can also give a navigation mode through your mind map. So that's five ways at least to give access to your content to your viewers. That's pretty powerful. Maybe you don't want to use them all, no problem. Just select the one you think would be interesting for your project, for your viewers to navigate in your project, okay? Very quickly about the mind map. I'm going to show you how you can customize it. So let me go back to Klynt. First of all, you can choose to play sequences description if you want to. Show the arrow or just show lines. Those are details you will see by yourselves. And you can also change the size. Look, on the storyboard, the sequences are represented by squares or rectangles. In the mind map, there are circles. Anyway, that's a tiny difference. And you can change the size if you want to. Though I do not necessarily recommend you do that because you could make the small be 500 and then small is bigger than large and you might get lost. And that's not maybe a good idea. So I will leave it back to 50. And also we do not have yet a reset button. So be careful with that. Maybe don't touch it. You can also change the colors. Like I had red, I could say red now is like that or is dark blue. Okay. Why not? And look, now what was red here became blue. And that can be a little confusing. So really you can work with that, but don't feel obliged to. In this case, I chose on purpose the same color I have for my text. So if I open this sequence here for my text in the scheme general design settings, if you remember. So now here I have the same color for text and this and that. This is really like thinking graphic design. You can put on your mind map only two or three colors, and that can be the same colors as your skin design settings. This way, you have a whole consistent graphic design, if you want to, but don't feel obliged. It's sort of really advanced use. You can stick to the colors you have in your mind map. But you can do it if you want to. Back to Klynt. And again, now, how can you customize the mind map for each and every sequence? What you can do, if I select, for example, the start sequence, I could say, okay, that's the start sequence. I can show it on the mind map or not show it on the mind map. And if I decide that, here it is gray. I hardly see it. It exists, but it's not accessible on the mind map. This one will be on the mind map. I can decide to show the thumbnail. Okay, let us show the thumbnail, but let us not show the title. So I will not see the title on the mind map. And if I select this picture, this sequence, I would decide to show it on the mind map. Don't show the thumbnail, but show the title. What about this one? Okay, show it on the mind map, but don't show no thumbnail and don't show no title. And what about the overlay sequence here with information on interest? Wow. Is it really worth to make it accessible for the viewers as a sequence of its own? Not really. Let me not show this one on the mind map. Now let me play the bar sequence, for instance. Now let me open the mind map and let's see what I just did. The start sequence, I have a very sensitive mouse, so sorry. The start sequence has a thumbnail, but it has no title unless I am rolling over it. And when rolling over it, I have a title name, a sequence name, duration, and description. But if I'm not rolling over, it has nothing. The menu sequence has no thumbnail, but it has a title. The concert sequence, I played it more abstract, has no title and no thumbnail. It's just a color. What about the overlay sequence? It disappeared. It's no longer on the mind map. I decided to hide it from the mind map. Does that mean I deleted it? No, it still exists. I can double click to see the concert sequence. And if I click Idris, You can see the overlay sequence is still here. The only difference is that I decided to hide it from the mind map because it would not be such a good idea to put it on the mind map. So basically, this is the sort of things you can do if you want to customize the mind map by yourself. We're almost done. I need to show you a few more stuff. Let's go back to the widget settings. Other things we have on the footer here are some footer items, such as sharing, sound, and I can change the label. And here I'll write down mute instead of sound if I wanted to mute. I have also made with Klynt logo, and if you have Klynt Professional Edition, you can take it away. If you have the Klynt Light Professional Light Edition, I'm sorry, you cannot take it away, but in this case I could. And let's say full screen, I'm gonna leave this item active, but don't show no label, just the icon will do. And you see that? So now I have share, and I have a box window we will see in a minute. I change the mute sound from mute for the label. And I put away the Made with Klynt logo because I have Klynt Professional Edition. And I left the full screen. Just put away the label. And I can click and go full screen. That works. Okay. And now, last thing we will see today is the sharing preferences. So, you can share your project through social networks. We have sort of already plugins ready for that. You can share it on Facebook, LinkedIn, Google+, Tumblr, and Twitter. So, just select default URL here, and automatically it will give the right URL where your project will be hosted. If you want to share your project on Facebook, LinkedIn, Google+, and Tumblr, you can write down a title message, such as My Great Production. Share a message, take a look of what I just did with Klynt, or whatever. There's a quick description, you know, as it's on a Google+, LinkedIn, or Facebook, or Tumblr post. You can also upload, you need to upload a share image. And once more, as for the background image in the skin general settings, this image should be probably sort of a cover image, the one that's the most powerful, relevant, compelling, and representative of your project. Quickly about Twitter. As you know, Twitter, as you probably know, Twitter has limited characters, 140 max, and even less because the link will be in here and the link is counts for 20 characters. So you could say 120. And we also automatically add made via Klynt app at Klynt_app at Klynt app. This is our Twitter account, and so automatically it would give this thing. So I would say the Twitter message should not be more than 100 characters, by the way. So I could say great web doc. Take a look, and that will do. And here you would have the URL copied here directly and the thing. So that can be enough. About the sharing window in the other tab. You can edit all those labels if you want to. Instead of social network, I'll write down social media. Instead of share sequence, I will write down share project, etc., etc., etc. Instead of link, I'll write down project link. But anyway, you got how simple it is to change the labels. And I have also an embed option. Remember the iframe? I'll write down iframe myself. Instead of embed, changing the label. Okay, let us preview the sharing window. Let me cut the sound. I just changed the label, share the project, that's the project link. Well, right now this is local desktop, so I could send that and nobody would be able to see it. But once it would be published online, this is how easily your people will be able to share your project, and of course share it through social media. And when clicking on one of these icons, the message you prepared will also appear that easily. And last but not least, what is pretty much important, let me take a look. Well, we're not connected here to Twitter, so anyway. Last but not least, what is important is the iframe here. I changed embed to iframe. Remember when we worked with the iframe, where I framed the YouTube video, I said we could work with anything from the web, any web resources, almost. And that's also true with the Klynt production. Let's say if somebody likes this project, say, oh, you did something great, I'm going to iframe it. I just need to copy the iframe code and I will paste it on my website or on my blog. And this way I'm sharing your project and allowing my viewers to see your project. So this is important in order to really give your project more visibility. Your friends can share it, or people who liked it and say, okay, I like that, I'm going to display it on my website and give another visibility window for new potential viewers. So that's kind of cool. And if you take a look, the size is 970 pixel 8. This is the default size of the player. And the width is 571 pixels. The player 8 was 545 pixels. Why is it now 571 pixels? Because the iframe will take the player plus the footer, which happens to be 26 pixel 8. This is why we have here 571 pixels. So when you are iframing the project, you will take the project with the smart footer in this case. So you can iframe it on its original size. You could also select the mini player. You have horizontal mini player and vertical mini player. What is the mini player? Let us take a look. Let's go here in the mini player. You can allow display or not display the mini player. Let us say, okay, I want a mini player. And it copies the project title from general information as well as a subtitle. Maybe I will write down something else here. Klynt webinar stuff, subtitle made with love, folks, and that will do. And once more, I can also put an image. And once more, this image should probably be the most compelling, relevant, representative image of your project, because in this case, it is really a cover image. So as for me, it would be a piña colada. I'll say okay, and then you can also edit those texts, but we will not do that for now. I will let you see that by yourselves. Let me take a look at the mini player. So this is what the mini player looks like. That's the horizontal mini player, cover image, title, and subtitle. And that's the vertical mini player, title and subtitle and cover image. What if I click the plus, the play button? It launches automatically the project in a full screen mode. And here we have new text such as thanks for watching, would you like to resume playback? Those texts you can edit if you want to. So what's the use of having a mini player? That's a good point. Remember, you can offer your project to be shared on its original size, or thanks with the mini player, it can be embedded almost everywhere. It is a very handy mini player. This is why we chose to do that. Because if we take a look, let's go, for instance, to a French newspaper, Le Monde, that's website, okay. Let's go see some, news article. And as you can see here, you think to yourself, this website has two columns, and the Klynt player, let me go back to Klynt to preview the mini player. This mini player here would probably fit here on the main column. So you could embed, if you had, let's say, a website of your own or a WordPress blog, and with two columns, you could put the mini player here. And even if it's too small, you could still use the vertical mini player and displayed in a sidebar or right or left column, right? This is why we chose to create and offer our Klynt users a mini player to iframe. And I think that's a pretty cool feature. I think we're pretty much done. It took a while, but we've been through many of Klynt features. Last thing to do before we finish this webinar, last but not least, we will now publish it on the web. How do you do that? Well, it's very simple. Go to the Klynt main menu file here and select Package for Web. Let us say your project is ready, you like it, you're very proud. You select Package for Web. Also work with the keyboard shortcut Command P. And then it takes a few seconds to do it. That's done already. Let me go back to the Finder. And in the Finder, we have a Klynt V2 folder, remember, and our project is in the July 31st folder. And now we have a new folder that wasn't here before. It's called July 31st Published to Web. And now the only thing you need to do is simply select everything that's in this folder and simply drag and drop it to an FTP such as CyberDuck here. You can use CyberDuck, FileZilla, Fetch, Transmit. There are plenty of FTP softwares which are free or freewares or very cheap. And you just need to use one of these FTP to simply take your project, which is I remind you, located locally on your computer. That is to say, to take this from your computer to a web server, and then your project is online. Quite simple. You just need to take everything that is in this folder. Not the folder itself, be careful, but everything that's in the folder. And that's it. Your project will be online. So that pretty much covers everything about the advanced feature. Now the idea is that you would see that by yourself and work on your own and discover all that by yourself. We will see you later, probably in a responsive webinar. Thank you very much for your attention and interest for Klynt. I'm Simon from Klynt. See you soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.